Hello, I'm X5, creator of X5 Cinema, and creative director of Alien Nostromo, a little bit of a fan film that I put together along with Max Headshot, who unfortunately doesn't like to talk, so I'm doing this solo. He was really hugely influential in this film, in that... Because originally when I conceived the idea, it was far more scaled back, and it was going to consist of almost entirely of gameplay. With maybe a few little, you know, bridge sequences thrown in to make it more interesting. But after I had seen Alien Covenant, and I will say that I was not a fan of the film at all, but after I had seen it, kind of re-sparked my interest in this project, which I had put off for almost a year. And then I came back to it and was looking at videos on YouTube, came across some stuff that Max had uploaded. I can't remember the exact video or the name of the video. I remember the video, believe me. And initially, I was just going to use that footage, but I got a hold of Max and asked if I could use it, get his permission to. He said, yeah, sure, you know, and he could get me a few additional shots. And after he had said that, it exploded. Like, I started wanting a bunch of content, and initially when he first started showing me stuff, I was really impressed, but then he started to understand what I was looking for, and oh my god, did the footage get impressive. And that's kind of what kicked it off. He started, every time he would send me a new video clip, I was more and more impressed, and then he started to really jive and understand exactly what I was looking for. And yeah, so that's how we kind of got involved, and it created this monstrosity of a little fan film. This intro was the very first shot. I like to assemble my films in order from beginning to end. And this intro I just really found set the vibe and mood. We're kind of skipping ahead quite a bit in the actual film, but I wanted this to be more of an abridged version. Which is why, like, we're here now with the egg, so we're just kind of skipping ahead a bunch of the stuff that's not really necessary for this purpose, especially if you've already seen the film. You know, you don't need to see the five or that 1 hour setup. We can cut it down to a 5 minute intro. That's all green screen right there too, by the way. The star field and the planet and all of that. It was a combination of a green screen effect, some Vegas movie studio effects, and then a actual star field, just a picture of the stars. And that created that cool little planet with my name in it. What I spent so much time, as I actually have a full-time job as well, and fortunately they have Wi-Fi, so I can listen to YouTube. So I basically had the Alien Covenant soundtrack in a loop, and I would spend 12-hour shifts listening to that Alien Covenant music, which, by the way, is probably the only redeeming quality of that film. No offense to people or fans of the Alien Covenant, but I was not. But that soundtrack is haunting. It is just creepy. And that's why you hear it here a little bit. It's not, this song isn't, this one just really set that atmosphere and that vibe. And naturally, I didn't show the chest burster. There's no scene in the actual game of it. But there was another reason too. I didn't, because I could have maybe used a film clip or something like that. However, I avoided that because I thought it was more impactful to not see it. And you actually see here where the camera, the way the camera is moving is intentional. So we see, you know, the moving down hallways like that. Sort of the alien birthing. So it's moving out into the world. What's really interesting too about this scene, this is Brett's death. was that Max had actually assembled a version that was almost shot for shot like the original film. However, my concern was that was the problem. It was literally almost exactly like the original film. It was really impressive what Max created. If people want to see that scene, they can go watch Alien, the 1979 film. So I actually wanted to create almost my only jump scare in the entire film. And that was this moment here. So it almost looks like we got set up shots and then a boom. So it was changing the original film, but introducing something a little new for new viewers to give them just something different. I mean, we've all seen Alien. I've probably seen it, you know, 100 times. And that's probably a pretty accurate assessment. There's a lot of little things, too, that I do where it's all supposed to just be setting up atmosphere. And there is actually a little bit of foreshadowing in the film as well. Where I wanted the alien to seem, you know, like you just saw how easily he took out Brett. So he's kind of thinking these are soft, squishy, easy to eat things. Which is why when he attacks Dallas, he's making all that noise. He's not afraid of Dallas, but then Dallas hits him with that flamethrower, which we'll get to. I'm assuming you've seen the film, so I'm not really ruining anything. But when we get to that, I'll kind of go into more detail on it. This here, too, is actually, if you listen very carefully, you can actually hear breathing. I took some audio that I found of like a doctor listening to somebody's breathing in and out, and I actually put that in this that scene there where Dallas was in visiting with mother, right? Was it mother?
The security system has shut a number of doors, so you'll need to gather equipment en route. Mother isn't really helping the situation.
Part of me thinks I could maybe shorten some of this stuff up, but what was really important here for the scenes with Dallas, and actually, I'll hold on here, because this is my favorite shot of the whole film. Love that shot. But was to kind of look at the Dallas scene as a roller coaster. So you're, the beginning here is sort of supposed to be that slow climb before you go down that first descent. So it's kind of a slow build-up. And the entire concept of the film was to constantly keep doing that, to ratchet up pace and kind of change it constantly. And I know that we all know what the alien looks like, which is actually another big reason why, for example, I wasn't really worried about showing it. In fact, that was kind of the whole idea was this is... All the other films have always kind of hit it, and I wanted to constantly do that too. That's why you see a lot of high contrast when we do see the alien, so that we never entirely see him. And you'll see that here, just for example, with this next shot, after Dallas activates this, after Lambert kind of cusses him out about taking his time. And you'll see what I mean, where it's just he's constantly kind of in high contrast lighting. You know, so you never really get a great shot of him. But as the film goes on, I'm more and more exposing him. And again, the reason for that is, one, we know what he looks like. So fear, I don't think, is necessarily seeing things. It's not being able to... Knowing something is that violent and fierce is what makes the alien, I think, frightening. And that's kind of what I wanted to depict here, was a sense of intelligence. And that's really hard to do. Like, how do you do that when you're trying to just tell, like, a film like this, where you only have 30-some-odd minutes? give the impression that the alien is, like, right now we know he's hunting Dallas, but I also wanted to imply almost that he almost knows what Dallas is trying to do. I know that none of that is something that you guys need to even think about. It's something that I think about as I'm putting a project together. Well, at least this project in particular. And there's some more of those amazing Max shots there. If you ever see the outtakes here, this is there's a reason I crouch right there. Go watch an outtake. You'll see why. Another big thing, too, was to constantly make the ship seem alive. So next time you listen to it, like here, we'll hear the wind howling through the vents. You'll hear heartbeats. You'll hear little other audio, like we had the breathing earlier. I wanted the ship to almost seem as if it's a, as if we're inside of a living human being or something like that. Everything about the alien experience to me has always been so visceral.
I'm just trying to get a reading here.
Especially the first three films. And believe it or not, this is going to probably shock some of you. The third film is probably my favorite. Even though most people hate it. It's probably my personal favorite. So again, here now, the concept is that he's luring Dallas into a trap. And now he's just going to bum rush him. And the reason he's bum rushing him just outright was the idea that, well, Brett went down so easily. So that's why I didn't edit out any of the sound here. I want it to sound like he's big and menacing and just lumbering. But that fire hurts. So now the alien is backing off, like, okay, I'm still going to kill you, Dallas, but I have to think of a new approach. So the concept here was actually to make the alien act as if he's winding up, almost like a coiled snake, so that's why you're seeing this slow movement here. As if he's angry or enraged. And now we see the coiling snake, so you see this quick acceleration, and another quick acceleration, and that again, that idea is this is coiled snake, and now he's just unleashing. So he's intentionally now making as much noise as possible, was my concept here. So I added some sound effects and so forth and pounding and combined it with that music to make him basically disorient Dallas intentionally. As if he's trying to overload Dallas's senses. And now Dallas is exactly where he wants him. Completely in a panic. Doesn't know where he's going to come from because the alien's intentionally making as much noise as possible. Dallas makes a mistake. So yes, there's that much thought put into. So I wanted each scene to have a very different vibe and feel to it. And that's why that was. This is actually what we're about to see here as Parker's talking was. This was just an amazing shot that Max had in one of his other videos. And I thought it'd be really cool if we hear them talking about the alien and how it's this perfect organism. You know, as Ash talks about it, and just the flame and everything being held and perfect, just nothing moving. It looks so cool, so beautiful. So again, this is supposed to be that slow ratcheting up. We just saw that, so now we're kind of have a slight cool down. And again, we're at another. You know, as a roller coaster goes, we went straight down, quick acceleration, and now we're kind of at the bottom, and we're going up the next incline. So it's just about that slow build.
Damn company. What about our lives?
And it's really important to note too that Dallas scene where he intentionally tries to overload Dallas's senses. That's the foreshadowing, and you'll see what I mean when Ripley has the same encounter with the alien. Except this time, Ripley does it to him. Which I thought was a really cool contrast.
our chances in the shuttle.
Good.
Some more shots. Just some fog added in post to give it a kind of a... I don't know. It just... Sometimes you put things together, and it's just because it feels right. It felt like it needed that. It looked cool. Here's an actual shot from the film. Just a still of the model. Wanted it as an establishing shot so we knew where Ripley was. And that's where Ripley is right now. Getting the shuttle ready. So again, all about that slow build. And you can actually hear it with the music. The Covenant music, man, by Jed. Jed was amazing, the music that he wrote. This music is just so off-putting. And by when I say off-putting, I mean in a good way, you know. Again, a lot of people have kind of questioned why he's moving so slow. Well, if you ever watched the original film, he wasn't this... I wanted him to seem more menacing, and being super fast kind of ruins that element. And this stuff was intentionally slowed down just for artistic purposes. You know, it looks more frightening as we hear them scream and we see, you know, everything kind of slowed down. It's sort of the same... The concept would have been, if you've ever been in a frightening situation, time does seem to kind of slow. It seems, it all starts very fast, and then it just time seems to slow. So again, that slow turn, Ripley now running. So again, that was a small little ratchet up. And now we're going back down. Quite literally, she climbs down. So now we're in a slowdown scene again, where the alien sort of prepares his next hunt. So this concept here then, for Ripley's scene, so I broke down each scene as with sort of the concept of a theme behind every scene. So with Dallas's is, it was more of he's being hunted. Whereas with Ripley, again, she is being hunted, but I wanted more of a cat and mouse game going on. Where the mouse sort of, I don't want to say Tom and Jerry it, but where the alien is starting to notice that either the humans are adapting to him, or that his particular victim is incredibly... is a bit more sophisticated than he would have thought. So he's not aware of that right now. He doesn't look at these as just easy prey anymore. They are obviously intelligent, but his plan is basically to try to sneak up on Ripley and catch her off guard once he can get his hands on her. I'm trying as much as I can to try to put myself in this alien's kind of position with what he's thinking, how he wants to... You know, he's not arrogant or cocky, he's just is what he is. And that is an animal, in just about every sense. And it's not that animals can't be obviously intelligent. It's just that I want him to seem like he's just built for this one thing, and he's the perfect instrument for it, and that is killing. So again, he doesn't know where she is exactly. He thinks he's got an idea, and then this is where he thinks he can get her. She pulls the lever, makes a bunch of noise. he comes out. Now, I don't think, obviously, Ripley thinks that she's doing anything. She does. She's just trying to survive and escape. But to the alien, the concept here was that he feels like he's been tricked and duped, which only makes him more angry. And that's why I don't know how do you express anger in something? You know, that's difficult when it's emotionless and doesn't have anything. So I took a lot of Max's footage, like here, where he just slowly rises again, almost as if, okay, you're fucking with me. Or you think you can fuck with me. So he goes back to the hunt, basically. Now this is where she's obviously trying to get to where she can blow up the ship. And again, she's still kind of... This is the whole like concept of what I was saying with the cat and mouse. The sense of being stalked. Which again is reminiscent to the Dallas stuff, but this is a bit more played out than Dallas's, where we cut back to the alien to almost see what the alien is, the alien's POV. So here there's that loud gassing hiss noise. And again, the alien is like, okay, you're not, she's not where he thought she was. Or he's not, yeah, well, you get it. She's not where he thought she would be. And a lot of this was just because I thought Max had some amazing footage. I love these shots where you don't see him, but you see sort of his, you know, outlines of him. And the alien just, the design of Giger's alien is probably, I mean, it's cliche to say it's probably the best monster in a film. But the way light hits it, it's sort of like it's never fully ever in light, even if it's well lit sometimes. I think, God, the developers at Creative Assembly did a hell of a job. So again, the whole concept of roller coaster still taking place. Ripley is about to get to the self-destruction stuff here, but I played this whole part and I had no idea where I was going. I just had to guess because I didn't want to use the motion tracker for this scene at all, like ever. So during the filming of this, I never used it for Ripley. I did for Dallas, but not with Ripley. I thought that it would be more... like more horrifying both for myself and maybe even the viewer to not, it's really tough to play this game without a motion tracker. Like you're so close. You know, you're panicking. But here again, we're on the ratcheting. So I wanted this to seem as if the alien was closing in on her, which is why we see him in the distance there. And then with each shot, he almost gets closer and closer to frame, giving the sense of closing the distance between him and her. And I never know. A lot of this stuff you're not supposed to notice, I think. I think it's supposed to be more subliminal, which is my sort of my approach to making this film. It's not always what I can... This is what I was talking about with creative freedom in some of my other... Another video was that this offered me that creative freedom. So like I said, see how he's just slowly kind of filling frame? And then he's really filling the frame. And, well, now he's in your face. So again, that was the whole idea there, is that he's just closing that distance between him and her. But what we don't know is that he thinks he's closing the distance. And this is where... How do you make the alien seem like he's surprised? And that's why the music cutting out works so great. And now, that very trick that he played on Dallas earlier to confuse Dallas is now being played on him. Now, I don't know if that's supposed to be self-conscious on Ripley's part. She had no intentions of that. But that's the way the alien takes it. See how the hissing, the sounds, the noise, the venting of gas, all of that's throwing his senses off a little bit. So he's not exactly sure anymore. So you see him constantly just kind of like, oh, what the hell, where do I go here? But he's realizing that his prey is a bit more clever than he thought. And here he kind of corners her, but she does have a flamethrower. So again, cat and mouse, and she's able to get away for this brief moment. These are my favorite shots of the film, right there. Like, oh my god, Max. Like, these over the shoulder, as if we're on board with the alien. As he stalks. That's so cool. It was almost as if you're watching, you know, Friday the 13th, and you're actually seeing the killer's point of view. Was another theme with the film. That's why I wasn't afraid to show him. The only real Jerry Goldsmith track is being used right now. He gets a credit in the credits. Again, I played this, I think I played this segment about 6 times, and I had to re-add a bunch of alarm sounds and create it entirely from scratch. So for example, this scene where the alien comes out, where I gave the impression almost as if he's birthing into the world. I don't know why I thought that was interesting, but I did, so that's why it looks like that here. And then he's growing, almost. And now he realizes he's got her cornered. And that's why I wanted that expression right there. However, why does he not just bum rush her? That flamethrower. And he remembers that. Remember we saw earlier with Dallas. He can't just come at her. He's like, he's testing it, you know? Like, everything about the AI in this game was great. But I wanted to try to see if I could capture that. And now he's just trying to put pressure on her to force her to put down her guard, but he's not backing down, you know? We're getting to... And there, just sees his opening and goes for it, but he's not able to do it. Obviously, I wanted to give the audience one last thought that maybe she could die. We all know Ripley makes it, but... Now, this is Max's biggest contribution to the film, at least in my mind. I had, I think, 4 versions of this film put together. And at the moment that Ripley gets to inside the ship and hits the button, the film basically comes to an end. And we see the ship, the Nostromo, blowing up in the distance, right? Max felt that it... And we had a bunch of shots of the alien basically closing in right here. Like, fast shots of the alien moving in. You know, cut twos. Danger. But Max thought, you know, we should show a little bit more, maybe as she prepares the ship for self-destruction. So the original edit basically didn't have any of this. After this moment, we cut straight to the explosion. So there's a shot from the film. Max got some additional footage because he thought, hey, we could do some more with this. And he had a bunch of footage that he gave me, so I started piecing it together. And my god, thank god he came up with that idea, you know? And actually, some of these shots are directly from the film. None of this stuff is, but there is a Blade Runner shot. There's 2 of them. You might have missed the first one, but the screen shaking here, the purge there, that's from Blade Runner, and God hopes that they don't freak out over a 2-second clip, or even that, if it's that long. And the idea, again, was close-up, so we kind of see Ripley's thoughts and feelings here. The countdown. I love these crossfades. And then she just closes her eyes. Like relief. And the alien fades into space. Into the blackness of space. Now, if you want a real Easter egg, the music that plays directly after this comes from Alien Covenant, but it's the birthing scene. So as the alien in Alien Covenant is being birthed, and that's the way it's used in Covenant, I'm using it for the alien's death. And if you read into that, you will... there is a bit of subliminal... Well, it's my Easter egg. It's me saying the birth of Alien in Alien Covenant was the death of the alien in 1979. In that, it's the... For me personally, it's sort of the death and my saying goodbye to the Alien franchise. Because I'm just not invested in it anymore. It's I know that sounds kind of cruel, but I really think that Ridley has no idea what he's doing anymore with the franchise. And it seems he's not interested in the alien. He's interested in this AI thing, which I don't understand why you wouldn't just go make a different film if that's your interest. So that's sort of what I was implying here. And that's why the music is, I felt suited so well. Here's some lovely green screen effects. I can't remember the guy's name off the top of my head. I think it's Green Screen Studios or something like that. Can't remember. But he had to have this clip up forever, ages. And I was like, that's the Narcissus. It's perfect. I could use it right here. So yeah, that was all... Leading up to the explosion was all Max. And there you go. There's my little movie. And it was a real honor to put it together. Max was such a huge help. He originally was just effects guy, but I made him producer, creative consultant, you know. He was huge. He was really, really... He is the biggest factor in making this film a possibility. It would not have been something I created had he not been on board. That's just about everything. I want to thank you guys all for sticking around. If you have any interest in helping me, you can visit my Patreon page. You can literally, it's X5 Cinema. There'll be a link probably in the description as well as in the video somewhere. So, till next time, thanks guys.